Hi, my name is Sharon Louden, and I'm the moderator and organizer of the New York Academy of Art Professional Practice Lecture Series, and it's more like a conversation series. We've been doing this for 9 years. This is our 9th year, and the key to this series is that we bring in people who are generous, who are accessible, who can speak truthfully, candidly. I'm very interested in candid information geared towards creating more, contributing to the art world, being more transparent. That is my dream before I die. I doubt I'm gonna get there, but if we can make it just a little bit more transparent, I'd be really happy. And to also have an opportunity for the students here and alumni here to be able to have access to these exceptional people. So every year I have an annual critics forum, and tonight we have absolutely exceptional, extraordinary people who I really respect, who are very generous, who love artists. I think you love artists, right? You do. And I really appreciate them. So I'm just going to go ahead and introduce them. Oh, but I should tell everybody who hasn't been here before, the format for these talks is that for the first 45 minutes, we'll have a moderated conversation. And I've sent everyone here questions that I may be asking, and I may usually go off script. And then after that 45 minutes, you all will then chime in. The first 45 minutes is to warm all of you up. That's the purpose. And for these wonderful people to share their knowledge and talk about things that maybe are not talked about enough. At least that's how I feel. So let's begin, and I'm going to be in all the way to my right is Paddy Johnson. Paddy Johnson, who's been here before, and I can't remember the year she's been here, but it was a while ago when I think it was early on. Anyway, I'm so happy for you to return. Thank you. She's the founding editor of ArtF City, which is a New York-based nonprofit, and that produces publishing projects in public art. I cannot talk today, I'm sorry. In addition to ArtF City, she has been published in magazines such as The New York Magazine, New York Times, and The Economist. She also runs this great podcast called Explain Me, and can you explain that a little bit? Sorry, I stumbled on that first thing.
Yeah, so Explain Me is a podcast that I run with an artist named William Pohida, and we talk about the intersection of art and politics. So we try to, sort of beyond just talking about that, we try to cover topics that maybe we feel would not necessarily get touched upon enough within the sort of mainstream press or art press. So a good example of that might be our conversation with Louden, Tally Hankus, about mid-career artists and what it means to manage your career as somebody in your 40s who sort of falls outside of the young, hot artist and the established, money-making, juggernaut artist.
Can you also talk about, so you're, can I say that ArtF City is still a blog? Can I say that?
You could. I don't think that it's really, I mean, we, ArtF City began as a blog in 2005.
Oh,
and we are a nonprofit that sort of supports publishing projects and commissions art. But currently the blog is updated fairly infrequently. It's updated when we have an episode of Explain Me to publicize, for example, or sometimes I will update it when I have something that I haven't written for someone else. The other thing I actually use it for is stories that sometimes get killed for political reasons that I can then publish on my own blog. So
that's awesome. Congratulations that you were the first blogger to earn a Creative Capital Arts Writers Grant from the Creative Capital Foundation for ArtF City, right?
Thank you. Yeah, that was in 2008.
Yeah, that's awesome. Thank you for being here. So to your left is Jasmine Weber, and Jasmine is currently an associate editor at Hyperallergic. You are also an artist, right? She is an arts writer and critic based here in Brooklyn, And she's particularly interested in Black art histories and visual culture. And you as an artist, you're working in portraiture, right? Mm-hmm. Conceptual photography and collage. Can you talk about that a little bit? I mean, are you still doing that actively, or are you mostly writing?
Yeah, I would say I'm mostly writing. I'm in a transition phase right now, having just graduated from college, where I was studying visual art and was making a lot of collage and doing a lot of film photography specifically. I still do. I mainly work on collage, but it is something that I'm still passionate about, that I still work towards on a semi-regular basis, but I will say that art writing has taken the helm a bit as I transition from school to professional field.
That's awesome. Thanks for being here.
Thank you.
And returning to the Academy is Andrew Russeth. Andrew is an art critic based here in New York. He's been the executive editor at Art News since 2014. He previously edited in Galleries New York. I'm not doing well today on these bios, sorry about that. A website that he co-founded at the New York Observer about the New York art world. And you also do a little bit of curating, right?
I have in the past, yeah.
You've done a little curating. And I asked you this the last time you were here for a critics forum. Talk about your passion for desserts. Can you a little bit? And how that's connected. I asked you that
last
time.
Surprise question. Yeah, that's true, you did. I'm very passionate about desserts. I love it.
Last time, you couldn't come up with the answer last time, but what's the connection? Because on your website, it has a prominent picture. I'm not sure what it is. I think it's a sundae or something.
Yeah, I think it's a big ice cream.
Correct.
I think there are certainly connections in terms of aesthetic enjoyment, things like that. But I guess what I always think about is art, figuring out criteria, what's good or bad, can be really hard. And obviously when you're having dessert, the criteria is not hard because you just want something that's beautiful and delicious and satisfying.
Wow.
And so I think it counterbalances maybe.
Great. I like the mixture on your Twitter and Instagram between art and desserts. It's pretty consistent.
I always sort of imagined that you were doing art walks and that you do an art tour and then finish it off with a piece of cake.
I do kind of plan it that
way.
Yeah.
You do?
Yeah, I try to.
Really?
It's like a reward for myself.
Yeah.
All right, I finally made it to Chelsea. It's 30 degrees and now I'm going to have a big cookie from Bottino or something.
That's fabulous. Okay, great. And to your left is Jessica Bell Brown. So Jessica is a writer, curator, and art historian based in Harlem, right? And you're currently a PhD candidate in modern contemporary art at the Department of Art and Archaeology at Princeton University. Can you talk about what your dissertation's about?
That's the worst question to ask someone who's dissertating.
I mean, I'm curious. I mean, you're there getting your PhD, so I think that would be a natural question.
Oh, no, you're right. I'm just kidding. So my dissertation is called Bad Attachments, and it looks at artists like Sam Gilliam and Joe Overstreet, who are painters, who committed abstractionists, and have varying degrees of attachment to Black aesthetics, so to speak. But they also were using similar aesthetic modalities in terms of taking canvas off of the stretcher bars and installing it in real, actual space. So the project looks at their practices in the context of the decade after the Civil Rights Bill passed in 1964, so 64 to 74-ish.
That's great.
Yeah.
Now, you've done a lot of different things. You are co-founder of the Black Art Incubator. Can you share a little bit about that? And that started when, in 2016?
Yeah. So Black Art Incubator was kind of like a social sculpture in that my colleagues, Kimberly Drew, Jess Lynn, and Taylor Aldridge, came together from various sectors within the art world and wanted to make the art world a little bit more transparent, mm-hmm. Especially to emerging artists and mm-hmm. critics. So we called on all of the fabulous curators and writers that we knew to come and knowledge share for 6 weeks as a part of a residency at Recess, which is a wonderful institution. So that was Black Art Incubator.
Yeah, it's great. And you've written a lot of essays. And some of the people you've written on are Eric Mack, Sam Gilliam, Jennifer Parker, Packer, Carrie James Marshall, Charles Way. I mean, how did you select those, and in what context were you writing these essays for?
Some of them were for museum exhibition catalogs. Others were book projects. And I think the long form essay is like the most excruciating thing for me to write, but it's the thing that I can't turn away from. It allows me to really dive deep and to be committed to understanding an artist and getting it right in such a way that criticism doesn't really kind of allow for. Criticism, you're focused on the object in front of you, whereas different kinds of conversations can unfold in a long-form essay, for me, at least.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Well, if everyone could please give a warm welcome to these exceptional writers who are here with us today. Thanks for coming. Welcome to the Academy. Okay, so let's get started with these questions. So I'd love to start with you, since you're here to the right of me. So tell me how you got started with writing, because I personally think writing is excruciating. It's like very, very difficult. All of you seem to be natural writers, to me, from the outside. Maybe perception is very different than reality. I would love to hear what your thoughts are about writing, but why do you do what you do? What's the interest? Why is it important to write about art in the first place?
Well, I think because I'm an academician, it sounds so weird to say, but it's true. We get a bad rep sometimes for being too jargony or too this or too that. And so writing for me was a way to step away from the expectations that are placed on art historians to be specialists. And so it's a way for me to say, hey, this is something that I don't know. Walk with me through my attempt at understanding it a little better.
Andrew, why do you do this? You seem addicted, you know, that you, yes, it
yeah.
seems like you have an addiction.
Yeah, I think yeah, it goes a lot of along the lines of what Jess was saying. I mean, just loving art, loving having the opportunity to kind of share that with others. And I feel like, right, we're all in this room art lovers, we kind of get it. A large part of the world does not, and feels like, for good reason sometimes, that the art world is not for them or doesn't want them. And so just the excitement of trying to like convert people, or Roberta Smith always says like her job is to get people indoors, get people into, you know, go to Chelsea, go see a show. That's exciting for me, and I love that. Yeah, addicted, for sure. I don't think I could do anything else at this point.
So I hope you don't mind me saying this. Well, it's going to be too late after I say it, but your dad is a photographer.
Yes.
Right? So did that come from your dad? Like, where did it come from?
I think we just grew up going to museums. I grew up in Minneapolis early on, and so I just have extremely fond memories of going to the Minneapolis Sculpture Garden, if anyone in the audience has been. Amazing place, the Spoon and Cherry. I mean, as a child, how can you not fall in love with art if you see that? And then across the street is the Walker, and there's a giant Oldenburg plug that oftentimes is hanging from the ceiling. And those are just two of the first memories I have growing up. And then we moved to New Jersey when I was pretty young, and then I think there's a rich tradition of people. You grow up in Jersey, you see New York City on the skyline, and you're like, I want to be part of that. And we grew up going to a lot of museums.
That's great. Thanks. So Jasmine, do you like to write because it comes out of being an artist? I mean, where did this come from?
So I would say that my interest in writing started off very separate from my interest in art. Mm-hmm. It wasn't until recently, like the past 2 to 3 years, that I really started to explore my interest in writing about art. And I also think that what Jessica said about inviting people to walk through your mind as you're figuring out this very same thing that you're writing about is something that I've really embraced, because even when I did start to write about art, I was really anxious about sharing it because I wasn't confident in my opinions and I wasn't confident in my ideas. And so I think that for me, I enjoy writing about art because it's a moment for me to step out of my comfort zone and to learn publicly and, as you were saying, to kind of open doors for people and to ask them to learn with you. And that's something that I've started to embrace.
Great. Now, Paddy, you were an artist too. Once an artist, always an artist, at least in my view. And you and I met because you wrote a review on my work for Time Out years ago, and I was so grateful to you and persisted to stay in touch with you all these years. And I've admired how opinionated you are too. You seem to be very free in how you write to me. Does it come naturally to you, and why do you do this?
It doesn't come naturally to me. I think like my boyfriend at one point was just begging for me to get better at this. Like he just.
Oh my God! Like, really? Because it doesn't appear that way to me.
No, I mean, thankfully I have gotten a little bit better over the years, but like this was a source of contention for a while.
Really?
Yeah. Oh, well, it's like I mean, you. Anybody who's tried to write, which is everybody, you know, if you do it online, and it's like, it's not easy to make a good sentence, and doing it in public can be kind of scary, and so there's a lot of kind of behind-the-scenes hand-wringing and stuff that goes on. But one of the things that kind of happened for me anyway is, I would describe myself as a feel big. If I have an opinion about an exhibition, it's not just like a small opinion. I have opinions about exhibitions I haven't seen. I have opinions about The Shed, for example. It's not open yet. Like, I'm excited to see it, you know? I think just like an artist like has this thing that they have to share and make with the world, no matter like whether it makes sense or not, like I feel that way about my own opinions. I just have to share them, and so I'll work on them till I feel like they're sharp. So that's sort of like the driving force. But I did want to give like one little bit of context to like, you know, Andrew, you said that like you kind of grew up going to museums. I did too. I think one difference for me, though, is that I have no recollection of them whatsoever. You know, I went when I was a kid, no memory of that. And that's because my memory is not really all that great. And like when Google came around, I was like, oh my God, this is like the best thing ever. Like I don't have to have, like it felt freeing. Like I don't have to have a great memory. I can like Google things. You know, the bad news is that I've searched the blog and found that I've written about things like 3 or 4 times, like several years like after the fact, because you forget that you've written about things. But that was also one thing that kind of felt freeing to me, was this sort of access to knowledge was something that then became something that I really wanted to know more. And be able to share more, and that was sort of a driving force behind teaching myself how to write.
Very cool. So let's bounce around a little bit. So Andrew, tell me a little bit what you look for when you write about art too. You know, that, well, you know, Paddy just mentioned that she has opinions I'm just gonna paraphrase, desires towards the things that you speak about. So how do you pick your subjects?
I think on the one hand, you're obviously, on the one hand, I almost divide into two categories. One thing is like, as a critic, you do just wanna review the big shows. It's exciting when you get that opportunity. You know, the Whitney Biennial rolls around, great. There's a big retrospective of Francis Picabia, awesome. I'm gonna be there the minute the museum opens. On the other hand, I think, for me, the excitement is kind of like, let me look where other people aren't looking, hopefully. Mm-hmm. And those are the really exciting things. Like, if something already has 2 or 3 reviews, unless there's something radically different that I feel like I can add to the conversation, I'd rather delve somewhere else. So, looking in more marginal areas, maybe.
Well, at the one, I remember this review you did of Damien Hirst at Venice Biennale, which I've talked to you about. I love that review. It was very sharp.
Thank you.
And very opinionated. Did you read other people's reviews of that show and decided to just counter it? I mean, because that's an example of somebody who would be written about, for example, because it's such a popular venue.
Totally, yeah, I mean, that's a combination of things. That was kind of like, that was such a big show that like, oh, and it opened in April. I didn't get to Venice until May, mm-hmm. and I was so excited to see it. And it's like, you can never write from JPEGs, but you were looking at the JPEGs, and I was like, what in the world is this? Like, this is insane. And I had read a lot of the reviews, which are kind of all over the map.
Yeah.
Although there are some really positive ones, which is really fun. And then, yeah, it was one of those cases where it was like, this has a lot of reviews, and I am just so excited to write kind of the opposite. And that's definitely the most extreme thing. I like to think I'm usually more measured, but in a case like that, kind of...
I hope you're
not getting measured. You can't resist just going to town on something like that.
Yeah, no, I don't think you... I mean, do you want to be measured? I mean, that...
Well, I just mean overall,
this.
You know. Yeah. That review was really just kind of like, let's just try to burn the house down.
Yeah,
sort of,
I know, I loved it. Okay, so Jess, you've written for, like, Hyperlurgic, Flash Art, the Brooklyn Rail, and when you were writing for them, how did you pick your subjects? And how did you pick them too for your dissertation? Like, what specifically, how did you narrow that down?
Yeah, I write in different, there's so many things that I write. And so, like, writing on different registers, rather. Mm-hmm. So, I try, when I engage in criticism, I try to write, what compels me. So when Dina Lawson's show, was it last year? I believe like last year, I think Dina Lawson had a show at Sycamore Jenkins, and I knew right away that I wanted to write about her work because she's just one of the most fascinating photographers working right now. Kara Walker had a show also at the same gallery in 2016, and I knew that it was going to be, like, there was going to be a lot of, like, laudatory language around her work.
Mm-hmm.
Because we kind of have this, like, sheep mentality, I think, in the art world. One person praises it, then everyone else is going to praise it. Mm. And I love Kara Walker. And she's actually has a piece in a show that I just curated. But there were some things about that exhibition that felt... to me needed to be said. And so I try to write the thing that I think needs to be said, whether it's, you know, positive or not so positive.
So it's in your gut.
Yeah, I would say. It's a direct way of engaging with an artist's most immediate output. And I think a form of collective processing too. Mm-hmm. So sometimes when I'm working on a piece, I'll text my friends, the friends in the art world. I'll talk to my husband, who's not in the art world, but is a really great critic and very direct. And try to kind of think about what's percolating.
Very cool.
Yeah.
And Jasmine, so you're an associate editor at Hyperlurgic. How does that work? So does it work that you get stories every day, or do you bring them to the table, or and then from either of those situations, do you get to choose what you want to write about?
Yeah, so I mean, I guess that's kind of the internet, of course, complicates things, because I mean, I'll come across things in like Google Alerts, and other publications will pick up stories. And then sometimes we'll get emails into our like tips to tell us about things that we should investigate. Because my job is associate news editor specifically, and I do a lot of criticism outside of that. So when it comes to exhibitions, I do have a lot of freedom in terms of I really am able to pick and choose what exhibitions speak to me and what I do think deserves a spotlight and what I think needs to kind of be probed further in the public. So I think that without the internet, my job would be a lot harder because it is really special to me that we are all writing these long form versions of criticism, but people are able to put out their opinions in the forms of very short tweets, whether or not they're involved in art and whether or not they're writers. And I think it's really fascinating to be able to read the opinions of other people who are sharing what they're interested in or sharing what they're not interested in, and then being inspired by that.
But what's the criteria by which you select your subjects?
In terms of my own subjects?
Yeah.
Well, I definitely do find myself drawn towards artists who are speaking about Black identity.
Mm-hmm.
One of my most recent reviews was not about Black identity specifically, but was a show called The OG Experience that I had actually kind of written off at first. It was like HBO-sponsored, inspired by a feature film that they're putting out.
Mm-hmm.
And so I went in on the last day, and it was all artwork by formerly incarcerated artists and curated by formerly incarcerated artists. And the work there, I found it to be so special.
Mm.
There was a lot of conceptual art just speaking about what it's like to be detained by the state and to have your life upended.
Mm-hmm.
And so I really am interested in shows like that, where I walk in and I'm genuinely surprised by how much the artwork is pushing me to reconsider my own beliefs and my own notions of what artwork by formerly incarcerated artists looks like. And because there is no set definition for things like Black artwork and for things like feminist artwork and queer artwork and artwork by formerly incarcerated artists. And I like being pushed outside of my boundary of what I think these things might look like, and I like writing through that.
That's awesome. So speaking of Twitter and short form quote criticism, I want to ask everybody about that. What is criticism today? Is it in what form? Like, is our opinions on Twitter our criticism? I mean, what are the forms it takes? And it seems like infinite. It seems like we've got podcasts, Hyperallergic has a podcast. It seems like it could come in the form of news, Twitter, Facebook, all of these different social media outlets. I mean, Paddy, what do you think? What is the form? What is our criticism today?
There is no short answer to that.
We have a while. Yeah. We have a little while. Can you try to attempt? Because I think it's an interesting question. I mean, is it able to be formed into an answer or not?
Well, I mean, I think one approach might be to take the sort of Andrew Russeth approach of, like, you know, this is how I decide I'm going to express my opinions, or the, like, or this is how I'm going to decide to do shows, or, you know, this is how I'm going to decide to express my opinions. And, like, one way is sort of the traditional sort of I see an art exhibition and I review it. And that means that I spend a bunch of time building a very specific argument, and it hangs on a particular hook.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think probably the best example of that I saw recently was the Michael Kimmelman review in the New York Times of the Hudson Yards development, where he broke down all of the sort of specific problems to do with the Hudson Yard development, and all of its particular failures, you know, failures on multiple levels.
Mm-hmm.
And it came with this, like, very fancy interface, too. So, you know, you, like, click along at each sentence every once in a while, and, like, the sort of art criticism as it pertains to architecture is sort of very well suited for this.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of zoom-in, fancy, interactive approach. And I think that's one way that it occurs. You know, another way that this can occur is, like, stuff that happens on Facebook or on Twitter. There's, like, tweet threads. This
Ooh.
Is a very common way that typically writers use this, but you also see, like, God, I remember, I think it was, like, a political thing, like, back when Donald Trump was, like, threatening North Korea before he had solved the North Korea nuclear war issues. Thankfully, that's all done. But, like, there was a lot of talk about, like, well, what happens? Can he just press a button and do things go boom. And, you know, I think there was somebody who worked at a particular nuclear facility that just broke down all, like, in this, like, I don't know, like 50 long tweet thread, all the ways in which actually this was not just going to be a, you know, press a button thing, that you really couldn't work this way. And then, and actually here's the state of our nukes right now. I think I remember something about like computer systems still having floppy disks. So that, like, so anyway.
So can that, I'm sorry to interrupt, can that happen then as a review? I mean, I think the key is...
I think that's not a review, but it's criticism, right?
Like, right,
so,
that's what I'm wanting to find for
you.
So,
you know, we might, you know, you have like the sort of traditional
right,
thing,
right,
and
right.
then you have criticism,
right.
and then you have trolling, you know? And
interesting.
I think that, like, I guess that's one thing that I had sort of hoped to come up here, because
sure.
I think that is something that we all have either witnessed or, you know, hopefully not, but most of us
absolutely.
Many of us have probably experienced trolling ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
And that is something that is very different, but I think kind of gets confused with, you know, what a critic and journalist does.
I know, I want to get to that. I want to pause for a second and get through just the criticism, but I want to come back to you on that, if you
okay.
don't mind.
Jess,
do you want to comment on this? And we're going to bounce around. Like, what do you think is criticism today? What forms does it take? I mean, I love what Paddy said, because it's mm-hmm. a contrast of that traditional versus something that is not noted in art history books. Certainly Twitter wasn't, or certainly not in those terrible Gardner books, for
yeah.
example.
Yeah, I'm still chewing on what Jasmine said earlier about, you know, the power of tweets being a way to relay opinions, and I think there's a lot to that. I think criticism simply to me is, what is this thing or circumstance or object experience asking of me, and what am I asking of it in return? And so that can happen in the form of a traditional or conventional essay and tweets. It can happen in memes or GIFs.
Interesting.
You know, it can happen in texts,
mm-hmm.
In DMs. Yeah, it's a way of processing.
Andrew, what do you think?
Yeah, I love that answer. I would be hard pressed to improve on. I would also add, I guess, I think for me, just going off of the expansiveness you're describing, I think it's just any independent response
mm-hmm.
to art.
Mm-hmm.
And to contrast it with trolling or differentiate it, maybe I would add that's done in good faith or something
yes.
like that. Any,
yeah.
you know, so from, you know, images and
mm-hmm.
tweets
mm-hmm.
To even, you know, something written in a guest book by someone after seeing a show, which you sometimes see. Yeah, I think of it in a really expansive sense.
Jasmine, any thoughts?
yeah, I think that what I appreciate, and still being new to the field, is the way that it seems like the idea of art criticism is rapidly expanding to allow more people to feel confident in their opinion, kind of going back to what I was saying before in terms of art criticism seeming like this field of giants and this field of legends
mm-hmm.
whose opinions were the end-all be-all
mm-hmm.
of exhibitions and reviews. And so I think that art criticism today is opening up to allow people access to art historical language that would previously only have been accessible to someone in a university library or in
mm-hmm.
a university classroom.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that's one thing that I'm focused on is making sure that while I like love academic writing, at the end of the day, making sure that people who don't love it are still able to participate in art criticism as readers and as writers.
That's great, thanks. So Paddy, about the critic, like who a critic is today. So in this lecture series, those of you who have attended before, you may have seen that many people who come here wear multiple hats. They wear tons of hats, And I think critics do too. Like, what is the definition of a critic then today? You know, if you have somebody on Twitter just giving, let's say, an opinion, for example, you know, and then there is that difference between a troll and someone who can be an authority. Like, who is a critic today then?
Well, I think Pete Wells wrote an article in the New York Times. He's a food, he's the dining critic, and he made the distinction between complaining and criticism.
What's that distinction?
I'm sure he would make the distinction better than I'll paraphrase, but like, you know, a complaint is not necessarily anything that somebody can or should do anything about. Mm-hmm. It is not necessarily relevant to everyone. It is simply a complaint. Like now I can't remember his examples.
No, it's okay.
You know, but I think that applies in the world of fine art as mm-hmm. well. Like, you know, you can complain like, oh, I didn't like these colors mm-hmm. in a painting. I think they, you know, I wish this was in red because that's my favorite color, mm-hmm. And I think it would look better. Or you can sort of offer something a little bit more substantive with, and that is an actual, I mean, that's a craft mm-hmm. that you have to learn. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so there's definitely something to, you know, this is how I built this argument. This is why I think this particular piece succeeds. This is why I think this particular piece does not. And here is my criteria for what that is. And then also here is the context within which this criteria comes from. Because I mean, I think that is the thing that makes art truly distinctive amongst all of the different kinds of criticism out there. Like, you know, if you watch a documentary, or you know, a TV series, let's say, the context within the context is less relevant than it is for art, where like everything around the piece, all like the time that it was made, like everything is part of its interpretation and meaning.
So 2 years ago now, and I was trying to remember, I think it was 2 years ago, maybe last year, you and I were in Nashville, Tennessee, and I was on this big tour, and me and Matthew Delegate had a conversation, and I asked the people who attended this talk in Nashville, I said to them, what do you need and want, the artists in the audience? There's maybe 50 people there in the audience, and a very vocal woman, I'll never forget it, sat next to you and said, turn to you, because she knew who you were, and she said, I need more writers in this community. And through my tours of the last 5 years, that is the number one complaint that I hear, is that artists need writers. And so we were talking about it, and one great thing that you said was, an artist can write on another artist's work. Can they then take on that role? What do you all think about that? I mean, I think that is really difficult, at least art criticism, to have objectivity in different small communities all over the country. There isn't a lot of writers. I mean, isn't it true that the Milwaukee arts critic just was laid off, right? So how many full-time art critics are there? And they're mostly, I believe, in urban areas, correct? So there's this great need. Can it be another artist? What do you think?
Well, I mean, I think that in those smaller communities, there may not be the critical distance that one would want. I mean, I think Peter Sheldahl once said that the great thing, it was important for critics to live in bigger cities because you need a bottomless supply of friends because you're... So that's obviously not the case in a smaller town. That said, I think it's really essential for artists to document and archive their own projects mm-hmm. because without that kind of diligence and sort of creative work, those things actually do get lost. And so I don't know whether that's criticism exactly. Actually, yes, it is, because I think with your definition, that's exactly what it is. I think that way of going about it is really essential, and I think we're starting, we may be starting to see more of that.
I think it's tricky because there's a need for it. I know, what do you all think about it? So who's a critic, and you know, what about artists writing for other artists?
Yeah, so I think that when it comes to artists writing for other artists, I understand what you're saying about this idea of critical distance. But I also think that that's the same situation for critics. Writing about an artist who's a friend is a lot more difficult and a lot less objective than writing about an artist that you've never met. And so I think that artists writing about artists is something that I would encourage, because they do bring a perspective in regards to form and the way that things come together that maybe not all critics would recognize. And so I think as long as there is an ability for the artist to be critical, right, outside of a personal,
right,
relationship.
So you were saying the context.
Yeah, I think that it's a really fascinating thing, and I think it can bring something really interesting to the conversation about art history.
Yeah. Andrew, what do you guys think? Or Jess, what do you think?
Yeah, I would just expand, like, I mean, I always tell artists, please, please write, because when you talk to them, they're always oftentimes so much more perceptive than any writer, I feel like.
Wow.
Because they're really,
That's,
you know,
awesome.
Their being in the world is just like, I make art this way. And consequently, they have very strong opinions, I find, about people who make other types of work. So yeah, I feel like I learn so much from artist friends who will just be, I'll be like, I thought that show was okay. And they'll be like, no, that was the worst show ever. And I'll tell you, like, they've been making that trash for 5 years. Da, da, da. Like, okay, like, this is really a new viewpoint. But what I want to definitely focus on what you said about the loss of the Milwaukee art critic.
Yes.
I think Seattle as well, 2-3 years ago, mm-hmm. Jen Graves, who was incredible, left The Stranger. So there is that kind of like hollowing out in these even big cities. I mean, it's terrifying to think of the United States that that cities that have big museums, mm-hmm. big art schools, mm-hmm. don't have a full-time art critic. Crazy. At the same time, I'm positive in some ways, because you see places, a lot of foundation support. It seems like, mm-hmm. Knight, Warhol, different groups.
Ford, too.
Ford as well, exactly, mm-hmm. Yeah. So like in Detroit, there's the website Arts Black that's been, mm-hmm. doing things. When I was in Minneapolis, I'm forgetting the name, but there was actually a print publication that was being put out. And
In Minneapolis,
yeah. Hmm. I think we saw it together.
We did see it together with Chris Larson. He started it.
Yeah.
He started it. It was like an artist-run publication
with
Sheila Dixon.
Yeah.
That's right.
Exactly. Yeah, and it seemed cool. And so it seems like stuff's bubbling up and there's a real desire for it.
I'm glad you brought that up, because then that means that artists can take it on themselves. I guess the reason why I'm talking about this is a professional practice lecture series, right? I want the artists in the audience and through this camera to be able to say, from all of you experts, like your validation that people, it's just as valid in some ways to people go ahead and do that versus waiting for an art news review. I mean, I think a lot of artists wait for these major reviews that may not even ever happen. So what can they do in the interim?
Yeah, I just want to add that there's a whole history of artists writing on other artists. Judd, Robert Morris.
Mel Bachner.
Exactly. Margaret Burroughs, mm-hmm. Frank Bowling. And I want to highlight Burroughs and Bowling, because they were writing on black artists at a time when no one was really writing on them. And, you know, like there's a Frank Bowling and Clement Greenberg had this long relationship, and Greenberg never wrote about his artwork, but Bowling wrote about so many people like Joe Overstreet, like Sam Gilliam, Al Loving, people who are more so household names now. And I think what I love about
artists writing on artists is that they often capture the internal debates happening between them in such a that are often shielded from the public. So things get really juicy when you get the artists talking. I always tell artists the same thing that you were saying, Paddy, like you have to document your own practice, you have to write. And I think so many times artists have, or just tell you a quick story, I'll probably be more articulate in that way, but I have a friend who's an artist and she is kind of new to navigating the gallery space and navigating how to talk about her work with reporters and whatnot. And she got really upset that certain language was applied to her work that was completely irrelevant. And I said to her, you know, it's your responsibility to know how you want your work to be talked about. And you have to relay that to people who you are in conversation with. You have to relay that to your gallery. And I think exactly what you said, people wait for others to step in and say the right thing, but you already know what the right thing is to you.
I love that you said that.
Yeah.
It's great. So. Okay, so two more questions. Is everybody getting warmed up? I'll be ready for you. So I always have to ask that question, this question, because of the waiting, but also a lot of young artists and students put writers way up here on a mountaintop, very far away. Like, can I touch you, for example? Like, oh my gosh, you're a real person. So how may an artist approach a critic? And I would love for you to talk about studio visits. So when Andrew was here last time with me, he was also here at another critics forum with, I think it was Carol Aquino and Ben Sutton and Ben Davis. And we talked about studio visits, and you said that, I'm paraphrasing again, that you hear from a lot of male or people who identify as men artists, but not that many women, actually. Is that one way to approach an artist? And I would love to hear from, approach a critic, artist approaching a critic. I'd love to hear from all of you, what ways in which can you be approached, or can you? Can you? Please. That would be great.
I think we're an approachable bunch.
I hope so.
Yeah, I mean, what I always say to that is, like, what writer is not delighted to hear from someone who's interested in their attention?
Nice.
Like, it doesn't mean that we're gonna like become best friends or whatever, of course. But yeah, I mean, some of my best kind of professional relationships have begun from an artist just dropping a note and saying like, "Hey, this was cool. The art I make is kind of related to something you were talking about." And sometimes we do studio visit and it's great and kind of we strike up a productive dialogue, and sometimes we don't. And sometimes it's just like, yeah, it's not my thing, and that's okay too. I mean, like, the worst that happens is the writer doesn't reply, but kind of like sees your name and files it away somewhere or goes away somewhere. So I always encourage people to reach out.
What do you think, Jasmine?
I love it when artists reach out to me. I mean, you just mentioned like through what channels. I mean, honestly, like, I feel like I live in a world of like DMs, so I have no problem with anyone reaching out to me on Instagram or anything like that. But I think that just like shooting someone an email just to say like I appreciate the work that you do and I want to introduce myself is a great thing. I love it when people do it to me, and I know that it was something that I appreciated when I was a college student, being able to send that to professors and to different academics that I admired. So I would encourage any artist to do that.
Great. Paddy?
I mean, what everybody said. I guess the one thing that I would add to it is that there is sort of a protocol that everybody can follow that would increase your success rate. And that tends to be just doing enough research to know who you are sending your work to and whether they would be interested. In the same way that, like, you know, you ideally would identify certain galleries that you think are like good fits for your work because they show similar, like, artists that that have a similar sensibility to you. You would do the same thing with a critic who has written about certain things that either you're involved with or like tangentially or like work that is of a certain, has a certain relationship to what you do. And you know, I think one time somebody wrote me this, you know, I run this blog, Art of City, somebody wrote me, "Dear Mr. City," like that.
Oh my, interesting. Seems like they didn't really do their research.
No, so.
That's very funny. Did you keep that? That's a keeper.
It's probably somewhere, yeah. I mean, that's the other
thing.
Oh my
God.
Like, I get like paranoid that I will lose a press release. So like my inbox is like I don't know, a cavern of, I don't think I've ever deleted.
Oh my God.
You never know when you might need it. So
okay.
It's all there.
Wow. Jess, how can people approach you? Or,
well, I think I agree with it, with everything that everyone has said. However, I think my attitude about studio visits has changed over the past decade or so. And I think I'm a little bit more self-conscious about asking for them. Often because you kind of, like, time is the most important currency. You can't get it back.
Correct.
And I think this applies both on the critic side or curator side and the artist side. You kind of have to know what you're looking for, like what you want to get out of it. And maybe not you knowing where the conversation is going to go, but knowing that there's a conversation to be had there in the first place. And so I say that I agree with everyone with the caveat that, like, you kind of have to approach these things with intention. And so it is about doing a little bit of research, understanding, you know, things that person may have written before, but also like having a few fully formed ideas to start or to get to the meat of the conversation is important too. Because you never want to like, I mean, everyone has bad studio visits, but occasionally, but you never want to walk away thinking, oh, that was terrible, or that was awful, or that was awkward, or that was a waste of my time. So I think having an idea as to what you want to get out of it is really important.
Okay, so thank you for that. So briefly, because I'm going over the time, can all of you just briefly answer this last question that I ask everybody before the end of the moderated portion of our event? I always ask a panel to share some general advice to graduate students in the audience. Like, what is the one key you would recommend? I asked all of you this in advance, to young artists to sustain their creative life. And you know I love saying sustain your creative life. So maybe you all could give a key. What's the key? Do you want to start?
There is no major key.
Well,
can give you some major keys.
There's no, certainly there's no, what is that? There's no one way to be an artist,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
And there's no guarantees either, right? Mm-hmm. I think the definition of success in big quotes is up to the individual. But what do you think is for someone to sustain or thrive? And there's also all different ways of thinking about what sustaining means.
Yeah, I think two things. The first is keep going. Keep going. Even when you feel as though you're failing, you gotta keep going, keep trucking through. And look at people like Amy Sherald in her 40s.
Oh, yeah.
You know, was waitressing for a very long time, had a whole art practice, and wasn't moving the way that she wanted it to. And then, you know, magic happens. But she kept going. Or people like Consuelo Canaga, self-taught photographer who didn't receive much attention, you know, when she was alive, but now is important. It was important then, but is important now. And the second thing that I would say is ask questions. Try to ask more questions than find answers, if that makes sense. Because that's going to keep the curiosity alive.
Yeah, curiosity is a great one. I'd underscore that. And I'm also going to do a Sheldahl quote, which is like, like, you just have to form a gang of people.
Yes.
That is just the number one, I think, important thing. Mm-hmm. I mean, you look at it historically, every successful artist has had the curator in their camp, the critic in their camp. Mm-hmm. And I look at, I'm in my mid-30s, I look at artists my age who are being really successful right now, they did that 10 years ago. There was just this kind of crew that, you know, it didn't mean they like had a conspiracy together, but they just had really aligned interests, supported each other, challenged each other clearly. And then I think that's also really important because over time, every single artist, even the most famous, even Jasper Johns, right? Like, there are just ups and downs in a career. There are good reviews and bad. There are hot market years. There are bad market years. There are hot market decades. There are bad market decades. And by having that kind of group of people, artists, curators, critics, who are keeping on challenging you, that I think is just hugely important.
That's great.
Well, I guess I'm speaking also as like a very recent graduate, but I think that aside from what you guys said, applying to like everything.
Yes.
And to never stop applying regardless of how many rejections you get, because it's not a reflection of your merit as an artist, but rather what they wanted exactly for whatever residency and for whatever spot in an exhibition open. That's something that I really have had to push myself with and has turned out to be extremely fruitful to me, for me, and without it, I wouldn't have my present job and I wouldn't have had opportunities to show my artwork that I now have. So that is my one thing.
It's great.
Well, I second everything that's been said so far. I think one thing that I always tell people is, I guess to just not be afraid of your own naivete. Like, especially, I mean, whenever you start out on any project, it doesn't matter how much experience you have, like, new things require new skill sets, and you're not gonna know everything in advance. And so I think it's sometimes, you know, and that's where I feel like the curiosity that everybody on this panel has been talking about is so important. Like, don't be afraid of your what you don't know, but be curious. And I think that will really get you places. And the other thing that I just wanted to say that I think is really important is to always find ways to pay yourself and to prioritize that over a lot of other things, because your life, you know, the life of an artist, as has been said, has like ups and downs. It is like any freelance career. Sometimes you'll have good years, sometimes you'll have bad years. And I think it's really important to be able to prioritize your own payment so that your life is more sustainable. And you can figure out ways to, you know, piece together these different streams of income, which is typically what ends up happening. And with that, I will say that wage, a working artist, what does it stand for?
In the greater economy.
In the greater economy, has all sorts of set rates. They are about to, I think, in the next few months, they're going to announce a commercial art contract using blockchain technology. So, and they already have a platform set up for institutional rates that scales given the size of an institution, so that you can figure out exactly how much you should be paid and ask for that. And it is my own personal opinion that you should not accept less.
Yeah, thank you for that. Wageforwork.com, just to be able to put that out there. Okay, so who wants to start?
As a painter, the name is solidified on my cover. How can you discern your opinions on art or true when you have imminent deadlines and don't have a lot of time to process and are not just based on what's happening at that moment?
Wow, it's a great question. Did you hear that? So the question is, if I can just paraphrase,
How do you know that your opinions are true, especially because, and help me with this, that if these critics are dealing with a lot of deadlines, right, they don't have a lot of time to process it. Is that about right? Great. Who wants to start? Patty?
Well, I think you don't, actually. Sometimes there are obvious cases where it's obviously bad. Usually, obviously good takes a lot more work to figure out why.
Interesting.
And a good, maybe this is, for myself, I usually don't, I don't know that I would feel confident in my own abilities as a critic if I didn't doubt and question my own opinions. And I say this after having begun saying, I have such strong opinions, I have to express them. I also have such strong self-doubt that there's a kind of rationalization and process by which a review goes through, where you kind of work out the ideas, and sometimes there is no assurance that mm-hmm. what you said is what's right. And I have gone back and looked at reviews that I've written in the past and realized that I don't believe those things anymore. So I mean, that's the other thing, context shifts, your opinion shift, and that's a good thing. You get more information and you can change your opinion with more information, and that's the way it should work, I think.
Andrew, what do you think?
Yeah, I think it's such an interesting question, because right there used to be, until 15, 20 years ago, this expectation that, especially that kind of deadline criticism you're asking about, there was an expectation it would just disappear. You know what I mean? You got the newspaper, you got the New Yorker, and then boom, toss it in the trash after a week or a few days. And I think that's still kind of an okay attitude to have. I mean, I see my role as a critic, especially when reviewing gallery shows, it's kind of like I want to really express as much as I can about how it feels at this moment in the air. Mm-hmm. Over time, hopefully, people agree with me, and some of the art I liked, I still like, and it ends up in museums and people like it, but like most of it's not, right? I think you try to get the facts right, because you know the answer to that. The opinions, who knows? I mean, the classic example is Baudelaire. You go back and read his reviews of The Salon, you have no idea what he's talking about, because he was praising all these things that are just completely forgotten, deaccessioned in storage basements of museums, and that's okay. I'm sure it was really fun to read at the time, and it's still sort of fun to read now.
What do you think? Either of you have any comments? You're on deadline all the time. So you just probably don't, do you have a lot of time to think through these things?
I have definitely had to learn how to accept my opinions quickly, because you're right, I am working on a lot of deadlines. I also think that there, as Patty was saying, there is a lot of merit in accepting the fact that your opinions are allowed to change. Your opinion on something does not have to be fixed. I do think that when you're positing an opinion into the world, it is much better to be able to provide context and to be able to back up what you're saying. But I don't think that you're married to that opinion for the rest of your life, whether in 6 months you revisit an artist who you once thought was not so great and you see it in a whole new light because you have a completely different context. I think that that's valid. And I just think that being able to accept your own opinions is an important step, rather than doubting whether or not they're true. Because at the end of the day, that's kind of antithetical to the idea of what an opinion is. It's not true mm-hmm. or false. It's mm-hmm. just a subjective opinion.
Point of view. Any thoughts, Jess?
I don't have anything to add.
Okay.
Yeah.
Very cool. Questions? Tom Finkelpearl, who's amazing luminary, who's here. I can't believe it. Oh my God, I can't believe you're here. I'm so excited. Do you? Yes.
Which is, there's this Cambodian artist, I think his name, does the Bastity kind of thing. I was talking to him about criticism in the wake of Pol Pot and the complete decimation of the entire arts community. And he said he had to start a school for art critics because the artists couldn't survive without a critic. So he was reteaching Cambodians how to write about art. And so I was just wondering about training. I know, Jess, you're in graduate school. Is that training to be a critic? I just wonder how people
were great question.
Is training enough?
It's a great question.
Yeah, I think in most cases, no. But I think in my case, yes, in that two of my advisors, Chika Okeke-Agulu and Hal Foster, are art critics or at one point had been art critics and don't shy away from, or don't encourage us as their, you know, pupils to shy away from that. I think the training aspect is riding your way through fear. Fear of getting it wrong, fear of failure, or of being shunned for for being that one person who says, "Hey, I actually didn't like this." Mm-hmm. I think that's it, really. It's just a matter of being in the practice of holding the mirror up to yourself, or to your mind every day. I say that from a comfortable seat, but for someone who wanted to be a critic and is doesn't have that experience, I think it's about what Jasmine was saying earlier, just knocking down knocking at every door. I remember when I had feelings and opinions and things that I wanted to write and no outlet to be able to do it and no connections to editors whatsoever to even say, hey, can this piece land here? So you can't wait for the right outlet to write. If you want to be a critic, you have to just write first and then the outlets will come later. But yeah, I think there's something, I think we all kind of were saying something, there's something about fear as a productive energy and also as something that we need to kind of tackle in order to be able to get those words on the page.
It sounds like you're an artist. Very similar.
Really?
I mean, you're saying the exact same things.
Yeah.
Any other thoughts?
The one thing I wanted to add to this is that I think it cuts both ways in terms of, like, I don't want to say, like, training for artists, too, but, like, I think that, like, there's a community of people that also has to get used to receiving art criticism and understanding what to do with it and how to interpret it and how to use it. And I think one of the problems that we have sort of seen as a result of this reduction in art criticism across the country is that there's sometimes it can be harder for artists to kind of know what to do with criticism when they receive it. And the thing that I'm thinking about specifically was recently, and Jasmine, you know more about this than me, but like, Hyperallergic published an article on Meow Wolf, and then Meow Wolf, which is a collective of artists that creates experiential art, and they're a huge juggernaut right now, and they're planning two additional locations from their Santa Fe original sort of experience art thing, and this particular article just said, like, you know, I have some questions about some of the politics about these installations, but it ended on a very kind of like, this should be a conversation. And the result was like a social media feed from Meow Wolf that encouraged trolling of the artist, of the writer. Write about dogs. And so, like that, I guess this is sort of where that was just really concerning to me.
Yeah, it was to me too.
And I think that if, I don't know whether it's idealistic to think that if maybe there was more of it, more criticism, there would kind of be less reactionary
kind of behavior, but I like to think that if we practice at it, we get good at it.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's a weird thing, like we're talking all the time, but somehow I feel like we're less good at it.
Yeah, so. That's interesting. Any other thoughts about, any other thoughts? Andrew?
Oh, sorry.
No, I was...
Oh, thanks. I would just add, I think for me, I found mentorship has been really important. I have a great mentor, Sarah Douglas, who edits Art News, and we've worked together for quite a few years now. I think if you can find someone who is a little bit more veteran, who you kind of trust, that has been hugely valuable. And also, I think it's come up a few times, just try writing if you're interested in doing it. I had a blog in college that I continued on. My first job out of college was teaching elementary school, and I kind of used the blog as a chance to like decompress and think about art and not children doing crazy things. And that kind of eventually led to a job.
That's great. Any thoughts? Okay. Other questions? What do we have here? Yes, we have a question here. Hi.
Thank you very much.
If the work is not your taste, how do you criticize it? Would you write on it?
I think to start out, I have my taste, for sure. I think ideally, if you're a critic whose mandate is to kind of like be a record for the art world, you try to get in the mindset of, I think Jerry Saltz has talked about this, so I'm gonna kind of steal his language. You wanna think about like, or at least I try to think about, what would make someone like this? Or I think what Jerry says is like, what kind of person would I be if I liked this? And so I still try to do it. Like if I walk into a show and I'm like, I really hate this, ugh. You know, this is just so shiny and stupid, of course it's bad. I'm like, well, like, you know, people obviously enjoy it. There's museums that have collected this, like let me stop and think and pull out the thing. But I think any artwork, there's something you like about it. There's something you can get out of it.
But can we ask you, does it have to be positive though? I mean, maybe criticism can be, I don't want to say negative, but critical. Like critical is information.
Totally.
Right?
I think what I'm not getting it so well, but I'm trying to get it, is like I think in the writing process for me, that's helpful. Mm-hmm. It's saying like, what would be good about this? And then being able to say, oh no, but like, I hate it because of this, and I'm right. I do a lot of binary thinking in my head, like, this is what would make it better, at least I think, I don't know, and like, this is, what I think about it.
I think hate, though, is good in a way. I mean, not to say that I would ever promote hate.
Yeah.
No, hold on, is because it's not apathy. Like, I always thought that apathy was the worst criticism you could get, because then there's no opinion.
Right. I mean, isn't it the worst thing in the world when you go to Chelsea and you're like, oh, I saw a bunch of shows that I was kind of expecting to see, and I don't really remember what I saw now an hour later.
Horrible
feeling. Like, much more fun to, like...
Yeah, right.
The pleasure of hating, William Hazlitt. Yeah,
right. I mean, I never want to promote hate, but I guess way or the other.
Constructive.
Yes. Thoughts about that?
Reminds me of the vessel, like your piece on the vessel.
Oh, what is that? Can you talk about that? Do you mind, Paddy? Jess, can you mention what you're just saying?
In the beginning, before everyone got here, I told Andrew that I read his piece on the vessel and I loved it, and we kind of had a kiki about, you know, whether or not I was excited to see it eventually, because I am going to go see it. It's, you know, Paddy, writing about things you haven't seen before. But The Vessel is this new sculpture that is, you know, that was commissioned from a designer whose name escapes me, Thomas something. Yes, and it is kind of like a giant staircase that really leads to nowhere. It looks... Some people say it looks like a shawarma. Some people are saying, to me, it kind of reminded me of like a beehive of some sorts. But there's this really interesting critique of it circulating around on the internet in terms of its it being this kind of monument to ableism. So it's, you know, all of these stairs, and there's one, I think there is one elevator. There could be more, but they're generally offered to those who are disabled, but nonetheless, it's a, you know, it's a, the thing that we're all loving to hate right now in the art world. That's the vessel. But anyway, in thinking about Andrew's review, I mean, I think you did, there was a turning point in it where you, I think, were working through what could be enjoyable about the experience. And I think that as a challenge in your writing is, I think it can be very productive. Yeah.
It's great. Paddy, you have thought? And Jasmine?
I'm forgetting now.
Oh, sorry about that.
All right. Other questions? Who's got another question? Right here.
Hi, my name is Bella. So for a little context, I'm a student at the University of Central Arkansas, and I'm from Texas. So I believe it was around last summer, there's a publication in Texas called Glass Tire, and there's, I think, one or two paid critics in all of Texas, which is a huge state. And they put out a call for university students from Texas to submit art criticism. So, which I thought was super interesting. So, sorry, I'm a little nervous.
No, it's okay. Don't be nervous.
So my question has to do with young artists writing about artists and where a background in art history comes into that. Because I think that was one thing. As a Texas person who saw this open call, loves art, am I the right person to write about art? I'm a studio artist, but I don't have a very strong art history background. Does that matter?
It's a great question. So it is sort of like this sort of pedigree that people think. That's, again, that goes back to who the critic is. And it's sad, in a way, if people are stopping because they're thinking they don't have the authority to do it, in my view. What do you think?
Well, just to give you a little bit of my background, by way of example, so when I went to undergrad, I did fine art. I was a, you know, visual arts major. And so I think I had to take, like, one elective per year, but it was a very conservative course. All I did was like figure drawing for 4 years. The other thing that they provided was one art history course per year, and the particular art history teacher did not like contemporary art.
Oh my God.
So I went through 4 years, and like the last year was the only year I got any contemporary art training at course. Like, I had one course.
Can I ask you a question about that? Was that after 1945? I mean, when did it stop? Like, what does that mean? Is it...
Well, this particular professor was let go. So then, so then the last year, it was after 1945. And, and I went to school in Canada, so it was all Canadian art. So
oh, my God.
I went to grad school at Rutgers, and I did not know who Matthew Barney was. And everybody was at my... All my fellow students were going to see who Matthew Barney was, and I was like, oh yeah, who's that? What? And I nearly got shunned. All of which is to say, and then I did 2 years of studio art at Rutgers, where I think there was one sort of class that dealt with art theory that I took. So I had almost no art history background when I started to write, which is, I guess, like, why I say, like, don't be afraid of your naivete. Like, also, I had zero writing experience. Like, none. I don't know whether it wasn't ignorance exactly. I just knew I could do it. Like, I was also probably unaware that I was bad at that time, but I trusted that.
Which is different.
Yes. but I did, like, I mean, I knew that I had the skill somewhere, but I, like, you know, I didn't have the courage. So it's something that, like, but that's why you submit it somewhere, right? Like, you get to work with an editor, like, that collaborative process makes, is a process that really kind of moves writing forward. And it's, like, it's really, like, the most rewarding thing, I think.
Jasmine, what do you think?
Yeah, I also didn't study art history.
Right.
So I studied ethnic studies and visual art. I did take a lot of art history classes. I wouldn't say a lot, actually, but I took like 4 art history classes during my 4 years of undergrad, and then all of my other art historical education was Googling things and going to the library. And so I think that valuing the merit that like a self-education has, I mean, if you're a college student now, you have access to JSTOR, like you always will, I think. And so, I mean, like, knowing what you're interested in, knowing specific artists or specific movements, and just Googling them, and there's so much knowledge there for you to gain. And I think that writing through it is a very valid way of learning about it.
Yeah, and I would just... Oops.
How much art history did you have?
I did undergrad in art history. I was... just thinking, I mean, it's amazing. I think it's really good advice. It's like you can just Google all this stuff now. And it's astonishing me to think how much that's changed in even the past 10 years. If you think about, I mean, in a way, of like we're stating the obvious, but I would guess that you, if you're, are you on Instagram? Yeah, it's like you're seeing more art in like a day of scrolling than like the average art history, contemporary, especially, than like the average art history student 20, 30 years ago was probably seeing in like a month. Because I mean, you hear these stories about like John Baldessari being at CalArts in the 60s, and they'd be like waiting for Art Forum to arrive, and they'd be like, this is what's happening in the world, and like they would misinterpret what shows, like what the art actually was, looking at the photographs, whereas like there's just, I think young people starting out, anyone starting out, just already by osmosis knows so much more. So yeah, I did an undergrad, which I loved, but that had its own problems as well. I mean, I came about, I did undergrad at Columbia, which was kind of, you know, very, still is in a very particular way of learning art history, and I feel like becoming a kind of general day-to-day critic, I had to kind of break some of that learning in terms of just looking at a broader field of things, and I think it's also changed a lot since I was there.
Jess, do you have any comments on that?
Yeah, I agree with everything that's been said. I studied art history in undergrad, and I'm doing a PhD in it, and as much as I like to complain about certain aspects of my field, I wouldn't take it for granted. There's nothing else that I would ever want to do too, I think. And I think as you learn more, you kind of abandon this idea that there is one art history, capital A, capital H. There isn't. There's so many people working on things that you probably have wanted to see or wanted to learn about in our field. It's just like academic life is just a slow, it's a slower pace of knowledge production. And so there are so many people out there doing incredible work in our field, but the demands are a little different when you are entering the world of criticism. You have to kind of be able to be more of a generalist and be able to kind of know that narrative that, you know, everyone supposedly already knows, but there are ways to, I think, get around that if that's not something that you want to pursue as a field. I think you can totally Google, you can get syllabi from your friends in art history or from universities that post their syllabi. It's so, the field is much more accessible now than it was, I think, 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago.
It's great. Yeah, Paddy.
One thing I just wanted to add is... I just wanted to add that, like, another way to just sort of get basic skills is to edit Wikipedia.
That's hard.
It's really hard, actually.
I've heard it's a, my husband does it, and it's just really challenging.
Well, it takes a little while to kind of... get the language, but I mean, one of the, like, it has a citation tool. You have to actually make 10 edits before you can make a new entry I know this because I decided to teach my class how to do Wikipedia, having not done it myself.
Wow.
So this is like sort of an experimentation of learning in public, right? Like I had my account blocked the other day, so like this is, it's, I find it amazing, actually. I love it, but it's sort of challenging, but it gives you all the kind of basic mechanics of like, where is a fact? What do I do with citations? Like, how do I get the basic information of an artist down? And that kind of raw mechanical skill is always gonna serve you well.
That's great. Okay, we have three questions left brief. Eugenie, do you wanna go first? And then Herod?
So my question's about the balance of power between the critic, the artist, and the curator.
Oh, that's good.
And the critics are the ones who have the power. And so, as it seems, at least, do you think about the power you wield when you're writing? And you're writing under deadline, you're writing quickly, you're processing your thoughts. And do you think about making and breaking reputations of artists and curators and institutions? I mean, I'm kind of exaggerating. I was very taken with Paddy's acknowledgement that, and you know, we all know that opinions change, but it's on the record. And then do you ever make, like, addend it? And this poor artist or curator and whatever, you know, who's been trashed is kind of like, is never gonna know that you've changed your mind and everyone, you know, your opinion's already out there floating around. So I'm just kind of curious about, do you think about the power you wield when you are sitting at your laptop tapping things out to meet a deadline and the effect that your words can have on all number of things?
Well, I think there's sort of a bunch of things there, but I guess to sort of boil it down, I would say I think about my responsibility, but I actually think that critics don't have that much power. There's certainly, like, if I had any say, Damien Hirst would not have as much money or yield as much, you know, influence as he does on the marketplace. That if, and I think most critics, there's a sort of agreement among critics on certain artists that yield more power than they. Then I think it's warranted. But I definitely feel like I have a responsibility to, and I try to think about this when I choose an artist to write about and how I write about them. Like, as a critic, you don't want to punch down, for example. Like, you don't want to give somebody a bad review who isn't really in the public eye enough to warrant it. You want to be careful with your words so that you are not sort of being mean, because I think there's a difference between being critical and just being nasty. And I think you also have a responsibility to be honest. And that means saying something is bad when it's bad, and having the courage to say that, because I do think that that's something that requires a lot, as well as pulling back when you need to, and just really making sure that your words are honest and truthful to you.
Great. Can you guys answer briefly? Because we're almost out of time. No worries. I think it was great what you said. Any brief response?
Yeah, I think that was a really good answer. I agree with a lot of the things. I think that not punching down is important. I mean, kind of early on, a more veteran critic made the point to me, like, if it's an artist's first show or second show, it's at a small gallery, you know, it's like, what's the point in writing a big trashy review? It's also, it's also like, you should, as a writer, think how you want to use your time. I also, another veteran writer once told me, I reviewed a show, was quite a while ago now, kind of a mid-career artist, someone who does well, and I was kind of like, I think, needlessly mean, and he said, he didn't even go into it, but he just said, like, I read your review, it was funny, but you know, I wouldn't have bothered doing that. And kind of like, that stuck with me, where it's like, you really just want to make sure you're using your time in a way that is bringing people up or offering a counterbalance to an opinion that you just think is off.
So I remember hitting my stride as a writer when I was actually working at MoMA, and I felt like this intense feeling of like a conflict of interest in that regard. But the projects that I had that I was working on kept me in the like 60s and 70s and not necessarily in the now. And so I took a lot of the opportunities that I had to write were about people who I think needed a little bit more care and attention. And so I wasn't necessarily concerned with the power balance in that regard, in terms of like making or breaking someone else's career. But I think there's so many people who we don't talk about. And so anytime that I have an opportunity to call attention to an artist's practice as a mode of like acknowledgement, I see you're working on this thing and you're, this interrogation that you're engaged with is so important and brings up all of these questions for me. And I think that we need to do a little bit more of that more often.
I can't agree with you more on that. Do you have anything to add briefly?
I mean, I would just say that being very new in the field, I feel like I just learned a lot from what you all had to say. So I don't think I have much to add.
That's so kind.
Absorbing.
And Herod?
Sure. I just wanted to jump off on Patty's thing. There are the Art and Feminism Wikipedia Editathons. It's actually a really cool group, and it does. And it's based on the idea that Wikipedia is actually really lacking in a lot of coverage of female artists, female writers. So it's groups who get together and train on how to create Wikipedia articles for everybody. And there, I mean, you can Google it, it's really, really cool. I wanted to ask, because, so the New York Academy of Art is specifically a very technique-oriented place. It's all about, you know, the skill and the materials going in. I've met critics who care a lot about how many hours went into this and the technique that was used and the materials and so forth. And I've also met plenty of critics who are like, I don't want to hear the backstory. Like, I just want to look at the thing on the wall. I just wanted to know, where do each of you fall?
Yeah, that's a really interesting question. I think, in some sense, it goes back to the question of taste. I think for me, that's amount of time spent, like perfection of technique is not necessarily where I would go to. But I guess, like, I think as a writer, as a critic, when you have the critic hat on, if you're looking at a work and you're saying, like, this is trying to be a technically perfect thing, then you kind of have to meet it on those terms. I think, like, to be honest, that's something I have trouble with, honestly. Like, if I'm looking at a work I'm not familiar with, like, I don't know, it looks pretty good. Like, the perspective looks pretty good to me. Like, I'm definitely not a connoisseur in that sense of, yeah. That's an interesting question.
I think the story is also in the form and in the technique too, whether or not artists are conscious of it. So I think I do tend to spend a little bit more time. If I have the opportunity to ask the artist directly, I will ask, because there is something, you know, making art is a form of compulsion, and so there's a reason behind everything to me, I think. Yeah.
Any thoughts, quickly?
I think that when it comes to technique, I am interested in terms of how the artist did it, what sort of training went into it. But I think that there's merits on both sides. I mean, looking at an artist like Kerry James Marshall, who's entirely formally trained, and you can see that in his work, and then he also deviates from it in a lot of ways. And then looking at an artist like Lynette Yedon-Boache, who makes her canvases in one day and doesn't work from models. And I think that both of their works are fascinating and beautiful, and I don't think that the fact that one canvas takes 24 hours and one canvas takes months and months takes away or from the concept behind what they're making. So I'm really looking more at what is the work about and what am I learning about the artist when I'm looking at it, rather than what am I learning about the artist's formal education.
Agree with all that. I think there is one approach that I find a little problematic, which can just sort of a little formulaic, which is the it seems to be like ubiquitous in the art prize sort of field, which is this prize that happens in Grand Rapids, mm-hmm. where it's that anybody can enter their art and they have to bid to get votes from people. Mm-hmm. So you go look at the art and there's an artist standing beside it telling you exactly how many hours went into the work. And I think like the pinnacle of that was this like giant mosaic of used lottery cards. So you knew exactly how many lottery tickets went into the mosaic, exactly how much the mosaic was then worth, and this thing you could look at, and it sort of packed up kind of neatly into something that was a lot of good sort of talking points for writers, but didn't really amount to much. So that's one thing that I tend to be like just a little cautious of.
Wow, we could spend a couple hours on that, actually. Last question.
Thank you. I went to a gallery yesterday, and I saw a show that I would like to write about, and I'm an artist as well, but I have not really written critiques before, but I think I'd like to write something about this one. And, you know, besides posting to Facebook, is there like a good list or places best to post for novice writers?
Doesn't it depend on the work that you want to submit and the fit of the publication? Is that, what do you think? Where should she submit, let's say, even still, in looking for it?
Well, I mean, I think if you're looking to self-publish, you know, you can always use the Medium, as which is just sort of a blog format for long form. The other thing, you didn't ask this question, but I want to just say it quickly. For anybody who's like looking to, who's new to writing art criticism, the number one mistake that I see is that people don't describe the exhibition, what is in it, and what is the space. So there's like a launch right into what the writer's opinions are, without giving the reader any understanding of what they're looking at.
I don't know myself much about self-publishing. I mean, I do know that Hyperallergic does accept pitches through our submittable, and then we also, so as news editor, I'm responsible for this weekly roundup of the art news that we specifically do, and I know Art News does their own daily called Art Movements, and so one of the things that I include in there are opportunities, and so some of them, I think just like keeping your eye out for like putting up a Google alert for like art opportunities and things like that, little random like universities and colleges will be looking for submissions for symposiums that they're doing to incorporate in different like reading materials. So really just like keeping an eye out on any social media channels for opportunities like that is what I could offer.
Yeah, I'd agree with everything that was said. I'd say it's really along the lines of what Sharon was saying, just like looking out for a publication that seems to be doing things that you're interested in, pitching. And the worst that happens, like I said before, it's like the worst that happens is they don't reply. And then you go elsewhere.
Well, I think we should.
Thank you.
Oh, go ahead. We have to conclude.
I'm just going to say that newsletters are also, there's just an article on how newsletters are the new thing. So if you want to sort of self-publish a newsletter and send your opinions out to your friends and people who care, that's something that is a good way to get the word out.
That's great. Well, Paddy, Jasmine, Andrew, and Jess, thank you so much for being here. You can follow them up here. You can see where they are. And I hope everybody returns on April 3rd. I know I'm going to have a lively discussion with Nayland Blake about pedagogy, so I hope you'll come and join us then. Thank you all so much for being here.